if anybody wants to come a little bit closer. Thank you all so much for coming. My name is Irene Sunwoo. I'm the Director of Exhibitions here at JSET. And we're really pleased to have this opening of the exhibition number 9, which has been curated and designed by Frida Escobedo. Before we get into the conversation or some of the content, I also just wanted to say some thank yous, specifically to our dean, Amal Andros, who unfortunately couldn't be with us tonight, but she's been incredibly supportive of the project from the start, so special thanks to her. I also wanted to thank our fantastic shop crew, our fantastic student team at exhibitions, and also our communications and events team for helping us organize this evening. So I'm also joined tonight by Luis Castañeda. Many of you might know him from his wonderful book, Spectacular Mexico 68, which I think we can all agree is the book on the Mexico City Olympics from 1968. So it's a real pleasure to have him here. And next to him, of course, is our guest of honor, Frida Escobedo, visiting from Mexico City, and Luis Carranza, a professor of architectural history at Roger Williams University and also a member of GSEP's faculty. So just to give a sort of short intro to this project, Frida's exhibition is, I would say, the third in a series of exhibitions that have been held here at the Arthur Ross Gallery, where we've done a little bit of curatorial experimentation in terms of working with contemporary practitioners and really approaching them in order to kind of develop a new project with them. So a really unique creative project that might give them an opportunity to test something out that they might not be able to do within the context of their own office or professional practice. So in February, we had a great exhibition with the photographer James Ewing on model photography, and then following that, a show on cinema by Liam Young, where he was able to present a brand new film project. So similar to that, when we approached Frida about doing a show here, it was kind of an open invitation, which put a lot of pressure on her to come up with something. So in fact, she did have the option, maybe she didn't realize at the time, if she wanted to, she could have shown some of her recent projects. She didn't know that, she just said. So maybe I was just tricking you into trying something totally new so that I could work with you on it. So it really was a very open invitation, and during one of our Skype conversations where Frida was brainstorming, she just sent me a little photograph of a sculpture that was under construction that she had found in an archive in France, I think, maybe probably the week before. And I didn't know anything about it, and maybe she didn't know that much about the photo at the time either, but she did some digging and exploring, and the exhibition that's here is really the outgrowth of that moment of curiosity and exploration for her. So the show, in short, and we'll talk about this in more detail, but the main subject at hand is the Route of Friendship, or the Ruta de la Amistad in Mexico City, which was a sculpture project developed in tandem with the Mexico City Olympics. And to just kind of get us in the spirit of Mexico in 1968, I thought we would just show a short little video clip that I'm sure you will all enjoy. And then we can take the conversation from there, since we'll have some really fantastic visuals and music. Thank you. I'll leave it to Luis Carranza to explain what we just saw.
Okay, so I wanted to So I wanted to start the conversation by asking Frida if she could just tell us a little bit about the project that she came to it, and what it is about the project that she is trying to kind of express here in this show.
I think it's important to say, first of all, that the piece that is central to this exhibition didn't make it on time. There's a delay. It's going to be here tomorrow, maybe installed next Tuesday. And it will be important to mention it because this is the piece that we want to present. It's inspired by the original Station Number 9 by Todd Williams, who is joining us tonight, and we're very, very honored that he is here. Thank you so much for coming. And as you can see here, and as Irene mentioned, this first glimpse of what these monumental sculptures were really in the inside happened in Orleans at the Bragg Center. I was doing some research, trying also to find a project to work with them for the biennial, and I had no idea also of what we were going to do. So they were collecting a lot of material from Matthias Gerrit's archive, and they had like on the corner of one of their pages a small picture of these sculptures, and this was the first time that I saw that these sculptures were not these solid, monumental, gigantic sculptures, but they were really flimsy, and then they really depended on human labor and like these very precarious structures, the scaffolds, and like bits and pieces of other buildings around Mexico City to be constructed. So it kind of contradicted the idea of the original purpose of the Ruta, which is to present Mexico as a very young and modern and sophisticated country, as Raquel Welch was showing us a time ago. And it shows this is the way that the country was really being built. This is a country that was built by human labor, by the small and fragile bits and pieces of the surrounding areas. I think that's
the
basic idea
behind the project. And what is your role within investigating this? What is your interest in terms of architecture or office, looking at a historical artifact, and kind of rethinking it? I know that's a hard question.
So yes. No, I know, but we have a traditional practice, I guess, in Mexico City, but we also like to take looks at things that are not really traditional architecture. So maybe this is a window of opportunity for us to review this idea of the ruin in Mexico. We're very interested in that. But also, I think we learn a lot from the past, and I don't know why, but there's like this thing about modernism, and I think this is something that we all share, that teaches a lot about our identity, not only in terms of the urban and the architectural, but also like almost in the psyche of the Mexican. So we're a little bit obsessed with that moment because it explains a lot about how we develop our idea of national identity, but also about who we are and who we are not. So yes, it's not an architectural project, but it has to do with the urban landscape, and it has to do with space, for sure, and it has to do with construction, but it's a different construction. It's a construction in public space. And this is also an idea that I'm very interested about, and this is probably something that was born out of my time at the GSD, the Art and Design of the Public Domain program, because this was like maybe like stepping outside the world of architecture and just like taking a look at other things. But it's still architecture, and it's still habitable, and it still produces space in some way.
Our other Luis, I have a question for you. Just picking up on Frida was saying about this public sculpture project in the city, and this being one of the many leftovers of the Olympic Committee's vision for 68. I mean, for you, how does this particular public sculpture project fit into that larger history?
Sure. So it's very interesting. If you were to walk around as I did a few years ago when I was just envisioning my own research project through Mexico City, you realize it's a unique city in the sense that it's actually, parts of it anyway, full of modernist ruins. There's all kinds of ruins in Mexico. There's very ancient ruins and there's also modern ruins. It's a city that has a lot of modernism. And the project we're looking at now is part of one of a number of initiatives for those Olympics, which themselves were full of other kinds of interventions in the city. So many interventions, in fact, that in a way they're kind of that those Olympics are kind of a prototype for what we understand as being normal today in Olympics. That cities, the Olympics are an opportunity for cities to totally reinvent themselves. So the Root of Friendship was just one of several very spectacular things that happened in the context of those Olympics. But my experience of it was kind of similar to something we were talking about earlier. I kind of stumbled upon what remains of these Olympics the way that one maybe stumbles upon an ancient ruin or something that looks very old but also very modern. And one has many of those moments when one walks around the fabric of Mexico City. So I think, for me, what's interesting about this kind of relationship with these artifacts is that, as a researcher as well, I was mystified by these fragments of something that looked like a very grand vision that wasn't quite that old, but that seemed also to be simultaneously old and also from a kind of, from the future as well. Sort of like that Raquel Welch video in its own way. So I enjoy that very much about, I enjoy the process of others creatively looking at that relationship as well.
Yeah. I was going to say that one of the things that I think is really interesting about this moment too is that how it represents a particular kind of shift in how Mexico tries to also present itself to the world. I mean, one of the calls I think that Pedro Ramirez Vázquez, the main organizer of the kind of Olympic Games had, was to basically present Mexico both as modern but also historically grounded, you know, and how to basically kind of negotiate this thing, no? And one of the things about, you know, kind of the Mexican interest in art started in the 1920s with the Mexican mural movement, right? That goes all the way through to the 1950s with the university campus. And then there's a kind of a shift, a rupture, with kind of abstract forms coming in. And Matias Geddes is a really interesting figure within that. And when he kind of proposes, you know, like a sculpture as a vehicle for kind of self-understanding, as a place for kind of looking at the world differently that is not ideologically kind of directed, like the muralist movement was proposing. You know, he kind of proposes like something kind of broader, and I think that the project of the Ruta de la Amistad has this kind of utopia. That is very similar to, say, the ideas from the 1920s or 1930s, you know, about a certain kind of transformation of society, but in this case it's done through these kinds of abstracted forms that one would perceive in different ways. I mean, and it's kind of important to note the transformation from, you know, being in a mural space and walking versus, say, looking at these forms and kind of, you know, zooming past them and modeling them.
Yeah, and just to give some context to some of you who might not be familiar with the premise for the sculpture project that Matias Goeritz gave to the participants, the requirements were that they were made of concrete, that they were brightly colored, and that they were gigantic, right? So it's really amazing to see the photos when there's actually a human figure for scale, because I think Todd's own piece is 6 meters high, and some of them are even bigger than that. So the idea was that when you were driving by on the brand new slick highway in Mexico City, that you could experience these sculptures in a succession, and that each of these would be crafted by a sculptor from a different country. So there were 17 different countries participating, but so that this, it had this experiential quality to it that was about modern technology in the new modernized Mexico City, but also that this was somehow linked to a sense of international peace and friendship. So there's a lot invested in these gigantic objects that It's quite striking today, when I went to visit Frida a couple of months ago, or maybe it was just a couple of weeks ago, actually. I you know, tried to go out and see as many of the sculptures as I could, and took a really crazy long Uber ride, and you know, it was amazing to just kind of see them in the distance, but experience them as they were supposed to be experienced from a passing car, but not being able to get out and see them. So it's a very fleeting experience with huge expectations imparted on them. So I had a question for Frida too, as someone who lives in the city and is able to experience them on an everyday basis, or maybe not, depending on where your destinations are. Like, for you and say your generation as well, what is the kind of general perception of these objects today? Since some of them have also been moved, which is an interesting project as well to discuss. But some of them are not necessarily as prominent as you might think, even though they're enormous in terms of scale. So I'm just wondering what, you know, is it really a ruin for people today, or is it a sort of forgotten history that you're trying to excavate?
Well, I think there's something in Mexico that attracts us to symbols, and this becomes, of course, like a very symbolic gesture, not just for a specific time, but also for a very specific emotion, you know, this national idealism, or a very like positive moment about what Mexico could be. When I was a kid, and the first earthquake that I can remember happened in '85. We had to move temporarily to my uncle's house, which was in Pedregal, very close to these sculptures. But at that time, already like the city had grown so much that these sculptures were surrounded by housing blocks and things like that. So the sculptures were not seen at the distance anymore. You could actually climb on top of them. We would go and climb on top of them to play. So we had kind of this relationship to the sculpture, you know? Like this was very playful to us. So in a way, we humanized them in a different way. They became familiar, we could touch the surface, but even at the time, I didn't realize that they were so fragile. Yeah. So there was something that was very monumental and still very present and very symbolic. So they were not a ruin. What was a ruin was this idea of development and of progress, because it was surrounded by the city. So the sculptures were still majestic, but the city was not giving them a chance to be like that anymore. Mm-hmm. And it changed over time because, yes, they were moved, and the contradiction is that they were moved because of the freeway. So actually, they were created to be looked at from the car, but then the car completely displaced the sculptures. Mm-hmm. So it kind of makes like a nice relationship to the critique that Matías Guedes was doing, because he was almost explaining that these sculptures would create like this idea of progress and maybe like even trigger some new areas in the city, but it was actually the highway that was creating that effect. Mm-hmm. And then the highway itself kind of just made this a ruin of an idea of a public sculpture.
I wonder actually in continuation with this, if we could talk a little bit about the relationship between the sculptures and urbanization and the idea of urbanization that they were, in essence, proposing. Because there's this kind of, you know, notion that art could kind of beget, you know, different living conditions. Huh?
So before he kind of sponsored an ambitious project, Garrett had an even more ambitious project for a giant highway that would crisscross the entirety of Mexico and then the entire country. And at, you know, certain intervals, there would be sculptures that would come first, and then cities would follow them throughout Mexico. So, of course, it's not a project in the sense that he never thought it would actually happen, but it was a kind of utopian vision that this project was supposed to be a realization of in a smaller scale. But he definitely believed that these sculptures could be sort of avatars for urban development, that they would come first and that the city would follow them, and that they would bring with them a certain idea of urbanization according to certain modernist ideas of what the city ought to be, and that they would by themselves have this effect on the urban landscape. And it is very paradoxical that, in a way, the sculptures, if you want to think about it like that, succeeded because the city grew with them. But maybe the city or the car took the metaphor a little too seriously and eventually displaced the sculptures themselves. And after the car was done, there was only cars and not sculptures anymore in a certain way. But yeah, these photographs you're seeing what was at that point the periphery of the city, the edges of the city, a frontier of the city, and a part of Mexico City that's very interesting, this very dramatic volcanic landscape. In Pedregal, which means in Spanish, was the kind of the rocky place, is a very interesting landscape in and of itself. And then this would look very much filled by a city that has grown tremendously since then and has transformed entirely.
I wanted to also ask Frida about the design process because it was actually a very unusual one. And I think the project of La Ruta de la Amistad itself as a design process for each of the artists was also very unusual. So can you just walk us through how you began and also what the culmination is, even though it's not present yet?
So the original idea was to recreate them in their full scale. Of course, we wanted to have number 9 in full scale right here at Columbia University, which was pretty difficult. So we had to scale it down. But it does relate to the history of the Ruta de la Amistad, because from what we understand from our research is that sculptures produced these beautiful models that they were shipped to Mexico, and then from the models, they actually like translated that into a monumental sculpture. So it's going almost like from a miniature idea or some like really an abstract idea, which we can see right here. These are photographs of the model into a full-scale sculpture. Sometimes not even with construction plans. It was just like an interpretation. So they had to come up with how to resolve the structure, calculate the weight, calculate the resistance of the materials, and then apply the color and the concrete. And then we did the exact same opposite thing. So it's from the photographs and from looking at the real sculptures that we tried to find like the bones underneath these sculptures and then translate it into a three-dimensional object that's scaled down. So it's like going full circle back in a very contradictory way. And it was also fun to see, because this is not a work that I did on my own, of course, but there's a team of people, a great team of people behind this. And the metal workers that actually fabricated the piece also were translating these photographs. So it was also going back to that image in that room, and in these photographs of people interpreting someone else's idea. And I think that's something crucial to understand in architecture and in urbanism. So that is like probably related to your first question, like how does this relate to my practice? It's understanding that moment where your idea is being executed by someone else and lived in a different way than you expect or and you plan. And this always happens.
Well, before we began this evening, I had a friend come up to me and I was kind of explaining the project to him. And he asked me, so is it a model? And I said, oh, I'm going to ask Frida.
Is it a model?
I don't know. I wouldn't know how to describe it. Yes, it's kind of hard. And I think it's this funny moment where I notice how some of my colleagues are doing also like experimental things, where when we were presenting the sister project of this piece, of the Orleans Biennial, I noticed that there were many architects that were flirting with the idea of maybe like doing some sculpture or just like doing some drawings or some research. So I think it's kind of hard to label now why we're doing things and what are we producing. So it's not specifically an architectural exhibition. It's not about just urban sculpture. It's not a model, but it's not a sculpture. So I think it will change depending on the context in which it is presented. So maybe now it's a sculpture because it's presented as a sculpture, but if it eventually goes into the public space, maybe it can become a playground, or maybe it can be something different. So
I think it's kind of interesting that the objects in their scale and how one would perceive them, and especially kind of in the gallery space. I mean, Matthias Geddes always thought about these things as primary form, so he's really describing them in terms of minimalist sculpture. And of course, I think as one of the earliest persons who's like dealing with minimalist sculpture, he's really thinking about the relationship between the spectator and the object and how one moves around it and so forth. In this case, being, in the case of the Ruta de la Amistad, being in the car, in a particular scale, it's going to be interesting to see the object here because of its relationship to the gallery space. You know, which obviously, when we look at those photographs, Williams's photographs of the model and its site, which are also very, very interesting in particular because they're kind of like they're in the middle of Prospect Park. We thought, you know, which is like very, very different from Mexico City, a little bit. You know, and to a certain extent, you know, like the idea was that these things were not only contextual to the Pedregal, but also that at some moment that they had to do with the city, that the city was always a kind of a reference point, you know, that they would allow the city to grow. But I think that they didn't realize how fast the city would grow. And that there was always a kind of play off of whatever the context was. To see it here, the play will be different. And it'll be interesting to see how people like react to it, how people interact with it, and especially once it has this kind of transparency as compared to the kind of massiveness that the objects initially have.
And we should also clarify, you'll see one of the images coming up of a contemporary photo of Frida and a team using one of her projects as a playground, I would say. So in Orleans at the biennial that just opened, I guess, last week. By the way, this is Frida's fourth exhibition this fall. she's tough as nails. She got through an earthquake, the hurricanes in Miami and in Puerto Rico have created delays for various projects. But she's still here smiling. And her birthday was on Monday, so she's had a really crazy fall. But anyway, so my point was that in Orleans, she had constructed number 16, which was by the French artist Olivier Seguin. So because she was working in New York with this invitation, you know, she turned to the United States contribution to the project. But in Orleans, the project that she did of the actual steel framework of the sculpture, also inspired by the photograph, is full scale. So about how high is that one?
Right now it's 6 meters, but it's going to be 8 meters.
Okay, so when it's finished, it's going to be 8 meters tall. But the question that I wanted to ask you, though, was because you're in this context and you have contained space where you could do something. You know, I think the clear project from the beginning was doing this full-scale sculpture, trying to get it as big as you could, and kind of dealing with fabrication and all of those questions. But quite interestingly, as an architect, you were tasked with doing all this archival research and also kind of real curating, you know, really picking out every object, figuring out how it's going to be laid out, what the experience would be, even what the content would be in the little booklet that we provided. So I was just curious, you know, what was your experience putting on your historian hat and how it might have differed from other projects of this type, or if you've done projects like this before and how this kind of introduced something new to your thinking process?
So we have been working with Pedro Ramirez Vázquez Archive before because I was invited to write an article for the 50th anniversary of Museo de Antropología, the National Anthropology Museum. So that was the first time I really did this kind of historical research, and it really opened me to this like really crazy world of the Pedro Ramirez Vázquez Archive and all the things that happened behind that. You're very right, like placing the sculpture and also Luis, no? Like when you place the sculpture in this like white box, it completely changes the idea of the object. And if there was something really important about having those photographs that could give you a distance again from the piece, like this is something that you look from afar. And these are staged photographs. These are from Pedro Ramirez Vázquez archive. They're meant to look monumental even when they're being built. And there's like there's some beauty about the composition of the photographs. So they're like highly aestheticized images. And you can tell like even like some of them are super nostalgic, like number 2 and number 9. Some of them like have these like tiny little human scale looking at the horizon, like if he was looking at the sea. But at the same time, we wanted to have something that was really like very proximal to the public. You know, like you can touch the sculpture. You can like you could really climb on top of that. Don't tell anyone, but you could do it. So it's almost like changing this idea of the monument, but not just the monument itself, but this idea of power, how power can be like rescaled and maybe reinterpreted in a different way. So that was, I think, the crucial point of the project, how you can transform that idea of something monumental, sociologically, ideologically, symbolical, and turn it into something a little bit more personal.
I wonder if, you know, and based on this, I think for context, and I think the best person to talk about this is, I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the whole kind of process of the, kind of like Ramirez Vázquez's kind of like hand in all this, and this issues of power and the monumentality and expression.
Sure. So for me, that bizarre archive is an archive where I spent a lot of time, maybe too much time. Ramirez Vázquez was a very powerful architect in mid-20th century Mexico. At one point in time, maybe the most powerful architect alive there, and a very influential person. Influential not just, or actually not really in terms of the architectural merit of his work, but because of the political connections of his work, the political resonance of his work. So he was part of a generation of architects who worked very closely with government agencies, who had built these very monumental things because they had basically the unlimited resources of a whole state apparatus to create these kinds of monuments and spectacles, the largest one of which were the Olympics. And since that moment, there's a culture around his persona that's very peculiar, let's say, of preserving a certain image of the grandeur of that moment. And there's many things about that moment, of course, that are also very sinister. And the event that some of you might resonate for some of you concerning, because there's several, but maybe the most traumatic event around those Olympics were the shootings of students who were protesting, not necessarily against the Olympics, but certainly against the regime that organized the Olympics. And also this photograph, of course, speaks to a whole other set of tensions around race and sports around that moment in time. And this is a photograph of the students who were demonstrating in a place where afterwards, not long after this photograph was taken, the forces of the state, which you're seeing in that photograph, seems like great timing for what I'm saying, opened fire against them. So it's a very dark moment also in Mexican cultural politics. And Ramirez Vázquez and a number of other architects and artists and figures like Garrett's themselves are embedded within this panorama too. So it's important to say that that was also part of the context we're discussing.
I think this is something really important because we're talking about almost like this idea of the mask in Mexican culture, like how there are always two sides of the history. The Olympic Games were very positive and they were about friendship and youth and sports and culture, but at the same time there was something happening on the other side of the street that was very closely related to this same exact moment.
And it's interesting that these monuments, because of their abstraction, don't necessarily keep the memories. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, because you know, you see them and they're just so kind of distant, they're so neutral. As compared to say, like murals, there's a ephemeral mural that was created during the time, like objects that were trying to represent exactly the moment. I mean, these things, in a sense, have the kind of timelessness that Pedro Ramirez Vázquez had asked Geritz to kind of embody within the idea, you know, that they should be abstract because he didn't want that, you know, like Latin American countries to show their national leaders or the Soviet countries to have images of Lenin or Marx on the sculptures, right? So they want to, you know, that to a certain extent, there's this kind of abstraction that almost dehistoricizes them, and it's kind of interesting how, and even in this, these photographs, there is this kind of almost like neutrality or just kind of genericness of it that doesn't speak about the kind of like very complex times, you know, that were happening at the time.
Some of them do actually. There's a beautiful one where you can see the construction office, like it's very precarious. You see that like it's plywood and some scrap materials. So there's like this very nostalgic moment. Some of them are really abstract, but behind this curtain of, you know, staged photographs, you can still get these peaks of reality and then through like a tiny window, maybe in the back.
Yeah, and so I think what I'm getting out of those last few comments is that there was this kind of desire to break away from these grand narratives that people like Ramirez-Vazquez established, and even Goeritz, the way that he promoted it and even wrote about it afterwards. And I think we should mention that during the research process, there was this detour that very serendipitously happened. Because Frida had selected number 9 by Claude Williams, we thought, we gotta find this guy. So we somehow hunted him down. It took a couple of weeks, I think, of intense phone calls and emails, and his gallerist, if she's here, Peg Wilson, was really the key, who put us in touch with Todd. And Frida and I went to go visit him in Maryland and found a whole other archive about La Ruta de la Amistad. So it was really a beautiful detour in terms of historical documents that we uncovered. So could you talk a little bit about some of maybe the things that you learned from Todd and through some of his wonderful items, which he so graciously loaned us for display?
Yes, you're right. And this was like a shared, I think, magical moment, because Todd just came to his dining room and he had this folder in his hands, and then he opened the folder and he had these original letters that we were looking in Mexico, like in the archives, in the Archivo General de la Nación, but there were only copies, and Andres and Axel, who were like very involved in the project, and thank you guys for doing such an amazing job, were like constantly trying to get a copy for the exhibition, and it was super difficult. And then the letters just came to us, which was like really magical. And the other beautiful layer about this is that we get to know the people who were behind the project. We get to know the stories behind it, and the experiences. It only not just happened with this project, but also with Estación 19, with Olivier Segan, which also very serendipitously changed over the course of the production of the piece, because Monsieur Segan is living now in Orleans, which we didn't know until we were like very advanced in the project for the Orleans magazine. So it's kind of like these things that you don't find that, but actually like come to you, like, well, they don't come to you. You were like very like, you know, like, you made them, like, come to us, they're inside of you. But yes, and what was also really interesting is to understand like how this moment was actually like very important for a generation of artists, especially like how this presented them to the world in a completely different way, and from what we learned from the stories that we had from Todd Williams was that this was his first monumental sculpture, and that this really made a shift in his career. So actually this was like the positive outlet that maybe Matias Gris was looking for. So there was some truth in his positivism about the Ruta de la Amistad, even though there was a dark side. So as I was saying, like, these were always two sides of the story.
Maybe we could open it up to the audience. Is there any questions or comments from anyone?
Is it possible that the artist who's here could say a little bit himself? I mean, if you give him just his own impression, just like anecdotal and whatever.
If
you
would
I mean,
like to share some words, of course, absolutely.
Yeah, I would love that. If it's okay. Like in particular, I'm also interested how hard it was at the time to be African American as an artist, and what the thing was with the politics, you know, and so and interesting how it's so, it's almost the same today. I mean, we have the same discussions with Trump and so on. In fact, the road of friendship runs into a wall.
Well, I don't know if I can tie it into what was going on today, to that particular time. Being involved in this project was something that I've never even thought about before. It was a new experience for me. And although there was a lot of things going on in this country at that time, the experience was far different and far removed from what was going on here in the States. Okay? I met people from all over, and together, I mean, it's called the root of Amistad, friendship. And it really was that way. We lived together in the same hotel. We ate breakfast, lunch, and dinner together. And we really formed a fellowship. And some of those people I know, and some of them are, I was about to say, I know today. There's very few of us alive today. I just happen to be one of them. But we kept in touch, especially the ones who lived here, like Mead Moore, Fonseca, Constantino Nivola, who was living out in the Hamptons before it became the Hamptons. we all kept in touch. And it was something, I was the only black person down there. But nobody made a big deal of it. I was accepted, and it was a far cry from what was going on here. I could say that there was one time, well, in the hotel, there was one incident where I think I might have told the story to Frida and Irene. We were in the hotel, and like I said, we met every day downstairs in the dining room. And this one particular day, I came down to the dining room and walked in, and you know, I was saying hello to everybody and stuff like that. And I noticed a group of people, a family, sitting at a table not too far from where we were. And they were all looking at me. And nobody ever paid that much attention to me, except for the people who knew me. Okay? And they started whispering amongst themselves. And as I got a little closer, I picked up the accents, so I knew that they were from home territory. Okay? They were Southerners. And they reminded me of where I was. They never said anything to me, which was not surprising. But every time I walked into the room, they would look up and follow me as I went about my business. But they would never say anything. But I guess their curiosity got the best of them. And they had to find out what was going on, what was I doing down there. And they started asking questions. The good thing about it, nobody told them anything. So, you know, they could have come to me, but they wouldn't. And that's the only tie-in to what was going on there. I met other Americans down there, but they just happened to be black. There were some black entertainers, musicians, and that was homecoming. You know, other than that, like I said, it was far removed from what I or any of us was experiencing here. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, and who curated the show? Like, who invited you here to be part, to represent the United States?
That was Herbert Beyer. Saw my work. Well, the first international show that I was in happened right after I got out of school. I had won a fellowship. And then the next year, I won another fellowship. And through that, I got invited to be in an exhibition that took place in Dakar, Senegal. They used my work for the cover, which you can see in the display case back there. Herbert Beyer saw that that pamphlet, and he became interested, and he spoke to Matthias Goetz about me. And that's how I got invited into the show. I think that no one ever told me this, but I think they wanted to make it, they wanted to include people of all different types. And at that time, I was one of like maybe five people who were doing sculpture in the United States who happened to be black. And they felt that my work fit into what they wanted to do.
And when you came back to New York, you know, there were not that many African Americans working. How was it? Did it help you? Were you ignored by the art, so-called art world, or like Manhattan-centric art world? How did they receive you afterwards?
Afterwards?
Yeah.
We got a few lines in the papers and magazines. It would always say, "And Todd Williams." They would name everybody else and say, "And Todd Williams." But they never, I never got any real publicity out of the show, out of that work here. But it did help me in other ways. While I was down in Mexico, Matthias Goetz, he played a big part in my career. he introduced me to a friend of his, a woman by the name of Annie DeMas, who was an agent. And when we got back here, she started representing me. And through her, I did about five or six big major sculpture works.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Anybody else?
And those public works that Todd's mentioning are actually in New York City. So in Williamsburg, in Harlem, and elsewhere, right? In Brooklyn?
Yeah, Harlem, the Bronx, and just spread around.
Yeah. So you definitely made your mark in the city. So we're so pleased to have you come back as well.
How old were you when you, because you're still very young. How old were you when you did this?
I was about 29.
28,
29, yes. I started, I was about 22. I skipped years pretty much schooling. I didn't go, I went to City College for about a year, right after high school. And there was a gap about three or four years before I went back to school. So by the time I got out of school, I was about 26 years old.
Uh-huh. Were you the youngest sculptor in the group of people working on the Junta de la Amistad?
I'm sorry?
Were you the youngest one?
Yes, I was the youngest one. Yeah, I was the youngest one. There was someone who was close. There were two who were close to me. One was from Mexico, and the other one was from Belgium, I think. Either Belgium or Poland. Poland. We were the youngest three. But of the three, I was the youngest.
Any other questions from the audience, or? Yeah, here.
I'm interested to hear from the artist, Marty, all short summary of the idea behind the specific piece, because we've been talking about it.
You want to know how I came?
She wants to hear more about your piece. It's beautiful, and she would like to hear more.
They have an idea about me.
About your sculpture and the Ruta de la Amistad.
It's hard to say how I work, because I really don't know. Most of the times I don't put anything down on paper. I'm a great daydreamer. And what I do is I just kind of let my mind go. I believe that the universe is full of ideas, and some of us can reach out and grab those ideas. And I happen to be one of those people who can do that. I don't know where, other than that, I don't know where they come from, but they're just there when I need them. And what happens is I start thinking about something and I get an idea. I usually have a vague idea of what I want to do. And I start thinking about it or daydreaming about it. And I get something in my mind and it's kind of fuzzy. It's like a picture that hasn't been developed yet. You've got it in the mix with the chemicals. You know, the negatives is in the chemicals and the picture's just starting to come through. I don't know if you folks have worked in photography before, but when you take a picture and you get a negative, you have to put it in chemicals. The chemicals make the picture come through on the piece of paper after you expose the paper to the negative, okay? And you put the pieces of paper or the photo piece in the chemicals, and you have to start stirring it, the chemicals around it. And it slowly starts to come into what you're looking for. I don't know if I could explain it better, because like I said, I really don't know where it all comes from. But I'm glad that I'm able to do it. Anybody else?
Anyone else? Well, should we wrap it up for the evening then? Well, thank you all so much for joining us. It's been a real pleasure.